Sorry, just one quick comment. Sheikh Taqi Al-Din al-Bahani does not say that the Qur'an is created, nor does he validate it. And actually, Hizb al-Tahrir specifically says that that entering into this topic and saying that the Qur'an is created is something that is completely unacceptable and wrong. And actually, sorry brother, the majority of what you accuse Hizb al-Tahrir of is actually incorrect. And I really ask you, Annie, for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, go verify your sources.
About my misquote?
Yes.
Okay.
You just made a general remark to absolve and exonerate Hizb al-Tahrir from what has been said, but everything which has been said is from his books.
Well, I've been a member of Hizb al-Tahrir for 14 years, and I know that what you're saying is not correct. It's inaccurate.
It's not inaccurate. It is inaccurate.
I studied all of the books of Hizb al-Tahrir.
You do not know the Kitab al-Sunnah, because if you
did,
if you studied, then you would have known the false that is in the books of Islam.
Okay, inshallah. We'll discuss afterwards, inshallah.
Throw something back. You made a comment here. Please correct your accusation regarding the quote from the Islamic Personality Part 1, the Shakhsiyyah al-Islamiyyah Part 1, that you mistranslated or misrepresented. There is nothing of defenders or anything like that. I made the comment, Jahan bin Safwan, that Ghilan al-Dimishqi, Ghilan ibn Abi Ghilan al-Dimishqi, and Hassan al-Basri, that all of them are defenders of Islam. This brother, who now wants to play ping pong with us, please correct your accusation. Here is the page of the actual print of Al-Shakhsiyyah al-Islamiyyah of Taqiyuddin al-Nabahani, 6th edition, 2001. The cover of the book is here. Alhamdulillah for technology. Innovation in the dunya, allow it. Lillahi alhamd. So when people make accusations, oh, you didn't say it. So they can walk out of here and say, wallahi, that speaker, I've been studying the books of Hizb al-Tahrir for so many years. I know that he's mistranslated and misquoted. Abbas Ikhwan. Here's the page, the chapter. The Muslim philosophers in Arabic. Alhamdulillah, we've underlined the quote that I mentioned. He mentions, regarding the Muslim philosophers, Sara ba'd al-ulama fi awakhir al-asr al-amawi wa awail al-asr al-abbasi kal-hasan al-basri wa ghaylan al-dimishqi wa jahm bin safwan. Any misquotes so far? At the end, he mentions that there were ulama at the end of the time of Ban Umayyah, the Umayyads, and the Abul Abbasides, or the Banu al-Abbas, such as Hassan al-Basri, Imam, thumbs up, walillahi alhamd, died 110, Imam of the Sunnah, met the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. He mentions likewise Ghilan al-Dimishqi, al-Qadri, denier of the pre-decree of Allah, one of the supporters of Irja, and Jahm bin Safwan, the man who called to the belief of the agnostics, or worse than that, the belief of the atheists, by denying the names and attributes of Allah. What does he say? وَلِهَذَا لَمْ يَحْصَلْ مِنْهُمْ أَيْ إِنْهِرَافْ فِي الْعَقَائِدِ. He said, and there is not to be found any deviation in their belief. Any deviation. Alongside the ikhtilaf in their various aqa'id, in their various doctrines. Alongside the fact that they differed with each other, that there is no deviation, even though their aqeedah differed with each other, there is actually no inhiraf in their aqeedah, contradiction. Then he mentions, فَكُلُّهُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. All of them are Muslims. Debatable. Jahm bin Safwan, the scholars declared him to be an unbeliever because of his atheism. مُدَافِعُونَ عَنِ الْإِسْلَامِ. Translate مُدَافِعُونَ, please. Barakallah. Just so that you don't say I translated it. So I asked my brother to translate مُدَافِعُونَ. Right, so you can't say, because that's what I said in the lecture. That they defended the religion. What does he say here? This brother who wants to play ping pong with us, we call it table tennis in England. He said, there is nothing of defenders or anything like that. when the people of Bid'ah, if the brother was to say to me, wallahi, I'm a bit confused, I can't remember this, please, can you at least quote to me? Then no problem. But when you accuse the people who are speaking here, wallahi, for 20 years or so, I've been giving lectures. And I always, if there's one thing that offends me, is that if I make a mistake, I don't mind correcting the mistake. But when normally I'm corrected, I'd like someone, at least if he's going to correct me upon knowledge. Don't put doubts into my mind, because if I didn't have this, the wife said, why don't you get an iPad? I'll help you in the doubt, get an iPad. Books, look at iPad. And I looked at the iPad and I thought, subhanAllah, this is you can carry a library around with you. So walillahi alhamd, now we have photocopy of the page itself. I showed you the front cover of the book itself. I told you that it's a 6th edition. Beirut, Darul Ummah, 2003, 6th edition. There's another edition also, 2001. Alright, no problem. This edition of Shakhsiyya Islamiyya that I've shown you the photocopy of is actually Darul Ummah Beirut 2003. This is what he says about them. It's not my invention. Then in another question, the same brother says, if you read the book earlier, you see how he condemns. What, is he mad? Is he schizophrenic? He's condemned Jahm bin Safwan. Then he says, however, they are ulama. All of them are Muslims. All of them defended the aqeedah. Mudafi'un an al-Islam. Defenders of Islam. But now he wants to convince me, this brother, how he condemns their ideas. He doesn't condemn their ideas. Unless you believe that he's some sort of, Jekyll and Hyde type of character. Wallahi, if you are going to speak about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we speak upon the haq. I don't say Taqiyuddin Nabahani is a kafir at all. Wallahi. But I say his ideas, that the actions of the believer are that the term al-qada wal-qadr, that the actions of the believer are from, that this term qada wal-qadr is found in any clear-cut text. This is the belief of Taqiyuddin Nabahani. Now the brother may tell me, well, if you read quite a few pages earlier, well, okay, khalas, I'll look up the book for you again. If you believe that we are lying upon you. Do not be deceived, ya ikhwan. Because people may walk out of here and say, well, he invented stories against the Qiyuddin. We're not inventing stories. He said what I said here. Related to the same topic, that the brother said, you call the rulers today Muslims. Because this is the hobby horse of Hizb al-Tahrir and other than them, Jamaat al-Jihad, Jamaat al-Hijra al-Takfir and other than them. Because there's a question here regarding the Jamaat, Hijra al-Takfir. That these organizations and these groups, that they focus upon the Muslim rulers. We need to remove them, kill them, replace them, put a khilafah in their place and so on. Because they believe that these rulers must be rebelled against. So look at the evidence of this individual who asked the question. Inshallah, because the handwriting is different to this brother's handwriting. I assume he's a different person. Inshallah, maybe he doesn't know. So I'll maybe enlighten him, inshallah, if I'm able to. He said, you call the rulers today Muslims, even though they rule by other than the land, other than the laws of Allah. Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Based on this, they are not Muslims. The ayah translates us, and whomsoever judges by what other than that which Allah has revealed, then they are the unbelievers. So he said, based upon this ayah, Surah Ma'idah, that they are not Muslims, so they are not to be obeyed. Anyways, how could you call them Muslims, even though this ayah considered them not to be Muslims? This is the selection of the people of Bid'ah. Not particularly, the questioner maybe doesn't know that there are other ayat in the book of Allah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the same surah, Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah also mentions, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. That whomsoever does not judge by what Allah has revealed, then they are the sinners. Allah also mentions in the same surah, Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. That whomsoever does not judge by what Allah has revealed, then they are the oppressors. So Allah mentions three terms with regard to those who do not judge by what Allah has revealed. Allah includes them in one ayah, كافرون. In another ayah, ظالمون. In another ayah, فاسقون. either they are unbelievers, or they are oppressors, or they are sinners. Three different places in Surah Ma'idah. The people of takfir and jihad and khilafah and remove the rulers and we have to fight them and get rid of them and whatever. And folk, and 90% of the time, those living in the West anyway, majority of these individuals live in the West, that their greatest enmity is towards the kingdom of Saudi Arabia and the countries in the Gulf. And they say we must remove them because they are kuffar, and this is what they quote. Which ayah do they pluck out of the Quran? This one. Humul kafirun. As if that ayah don't exist. The ulama, they have stated, and there are different explanations of this, and we, as we said, that we take from whom? Kitab, Sunnah, and what was the third? Sahaba. We don't want your understanding. We don't want Taqiyuddin's understanding, nor Sayyid Qutb, nor Al-Mawdudi. We don't want their understanding. We want the understanding of the Sahaba. This is why at the beginning, in the middle of my lecture, what did I say? Read the books of Aqidah of old. And one point that I forgot to mention in my lecture is that every single book that I quoted, and more than those books, whether it be Imam Ahmad Asul Sunnah, or Barbahari Sharf Sunnah, or Imam Al-Tahawi's Aqidah, or whether it be a Sunnah of Imam Abdullah bin Imam Ahmad, or Al-Marwazi, or other than them from the books of Aqidah, every single one of them has a point in there that mentions the forbiddance of rebelling against the tyrannical ruler. They didn't say rebel against the ruler. They make a point of the forbiddance of rebelling against the tyrannical ruler by the consensus of the scholars and the consensus of the Sahaba. And I mentioned to you the statement of Usama bin Zayd. And I mentioned to you the statement of the Prophet ﷺ. So now, do you believe when the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith that our brother Abu Hakim mentioned, the same hadith I mentioned, I didn't have a conversation with Abu Hakim, Hafidhullah, between him coming to the podium at the front and between me quoting the same hadith in my lecture. There was no conversation between us. But it shows the reality of the evidences that we utilize. The words of the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ said that your rulers will not follow the sunnah. They will not follow guidance. They will have the hearts of devils in the bodies of men. They will beat you in your back and they will take your wealth away from you. But the Prophet ﷺ still commanded them. Isma' wa'atiyah. Lil Amir. Hear and obey who? The Amir. So a man with these five characteristics as a ruler, knows not following the sunnah, not following the guidance, heart of a devil, beating them in the back, and taking their wealth, the Prophet ﷺ, what title did he give him? Amir. Still called him the Amir. Even with all of those crimes that this man commits, said, hear and obey him. In the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, obedience isn't only that which is good. Meaning, if he commands you with evil, in that issue you don't obey him. He tells you drink whiskey, you say, no, I'm not going to drink whiskey. But as for that which he commands you other than the haram, you must obey him. Even if he is evil. Even if he is sinful. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Now a man wants to bring this hadith, or the questioner wants to bring this ayah. Do you believe, let me ask you, you are Muslimun. There are no non-Muslims here, is there? No. All of you are Muslims. Do you believe that the Messenger of Allah contradicts Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Never. So I've quoted a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Does this hadith contradict this ayah? No, it does not. No contradiction between the two. Why? Because between the Quran and the Sunnah, there is no contradiction. Between the Quran and the Quran, there is no contradiction. Between the Sunnah and the Sunnah, there is no contradiction. The contradiction is in the weakness of one's understanding. That's where the contradiction comes in. Because we don't understand the texts. So now when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that they will not follow my sunnah. They will not follow my guidance. They will have the hearts of devils and they will take the wealth unjustly and they will beat you in your back. That's what the Prophet ﷺ said. Is this in accordance to the judgment of Allah or against the judgment of Allah? When a person does all of these crimes, is it in accordance to the judgment of Allah or against the judgment of Allah? Against. But the Prophet ﷺ said, hear them and obey them still. That's not a contradiction to this ayah. Let's go back to the Sahaba, because the Sahaba are the ones that understood this ayah better than any of the people of today. Whether it be Bin Laden, whether it be other than Bin Laden, whether it be Musab al-Zarqawi, Abu Musab al-Zarqawi, or any of those individuals who now come with this modern understanding, or Sayyid Qutb al-Mawdudi, they come with this modern understanding that they want to give to the Quran. So they write the Quran with the understanding of Lenin and Marx, or Alexis Carroll, or other than them, like Sayyid Qutb did, read the books of the philosophers of France and Germany, then wrote his tafsir based upon that. So much so that what did he say about Islam? He said Islam is a perfect combination of communism and Christianity. Is that what Islam is understanding? Well, Sayyid Qutb al-Mawdudi. They come with this modern understanding that they want to give to the Quran. So they write the Quran with the understanding of Lenin and Marx, or Alexis Carroll, or other than them, like Sayyid Qutb did. Read the books of the philosophers of France and Germany. Then wrote his tafsir based upon that. So much so that what did he say about Islam? He said Islam is a perfect combination of communism and Christianity. Is that what Islam is, Ya Akhwan? A combination of communism, of Marxism and Christianity? Is that the qawl of Abu Bakr or Umar or Uthman or Ali that he's got? It's not their qawl, it's not their saying, it's his saying. And that's why when those types of books are read, and they have been read for two or three generations now, it is no wonder that the Ummah is in the mess that it's in. Because children, for the last quarter of a century or half of a century, have been nurtured upon the books of Mawdudi and Sayyid Qutb. Sayyid Qutb, when he was put in the dock in Egypt, and he was asked, from where did you get some of your ideas? He said, I read the books of Mawdudi. Mawdudi was actually older than Sayyid Qutb. He was reading the books of Mawdudi. France, it wasn't the only place. As I mentioned, he read Marx. He read Lenin. He read Alexis Carroll. He started transferring the barbarism of the French philosophers and transferring it into Islam. And then he said, we are living in Jahiliyyah. A Jahiliyyah like the Jahiliyyah of the time of the Prophet, before the coming of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said that even the Mu'adhin who calls the Adhan from the minaret, even this one is a kafir. The Mu'adhin, why? Because the government appoints him to call the Adhan and he has not actualized the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in reality. He has not understood La ilaha illa in his eyes. Why? Because La ilaha illa in his eyes is that there is no judgment except for Allah. So since he contradicts that, why? Because he's calling the Adhan and the rulers have appointed him called the Adhan. Sayyid Qutb make takfir upon the Ummah. This is Sayyid Qutb. Now, if I say this about Sayyid Qutb, why should anyone be offended? Why? We don't criticize when a man makes a mistake. I didn't even make a mistake and the man criticized me. But that's allowed, huh? MashaAllah. I didn't even make a mistake in the man center, but no telling me that I've made a mistake. Sayyid Qutb, who actually made a mistake, Taqiyuddin Nabahani, actually made mistakes, but those mistakes are not acceptable. Invent mistakes against us, but the real mistakes that we can prove and show that those individuals made, they are not acceptable to you. Why? Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, and other than him from the Sahaba, they quoted this ayah. Do you sell the book that you have? Right, outside there's a book. I advise everyone who has confusion about this affair, go outside, there's a book called The Rise of Jihadist Extremism in the West. A whole chapter dedicated to this ayah. And other affairs also. About this issue of rulership and rule and politics and so on, and the correct position of the Sunnah with regard to these affairs. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he quoted this ayah. He said, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ لِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. He said, it is not the kufr that you think it is. Rather, it is the kufr lesser than kufr. It is kufr lesser than kufr. Imam al-Bukhari has a chapter heading. Bab kufr dun kufr. Chapter heading, kufr lesser than kufr. The kufr that does not exit from the fold of Islam. It is the kufr of sin. So the one who does not judge by what Allah has revealed, then this individual is not. And the asl, as Ibn Abdul Bar mentioned in Tamheed. Ibn Abdul Bar in Tamheed, he mentions that the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, and those who came after them. He mentioned all of them have agreed that the origin of this ayah, that the verdict that he mentioned this ayah is kufr dun kufr, as has been established from the Sahaba, like Abdullah ibn Abbas, and then he quotes Mujahid from the Tabi'een, the Sultan ibn Abbas, and other than them, that all of them they said that this is the kufr that does not exit from the fold of Islam, and upon this there is consensus. This is consensus, that the meaning of this ayah is not that it ejects a person from the fold of Islam. Secondly, Ya Ikhwan, with regard to this ayah, Humul Kafirun, is it possible for a person that he does an action or a deed or makes a statement that takes him outside the fold of Islam? Yes, it is possible. If a person denies the Quran, he says that this chapter or this surah in the Quran is not from the Quran. Kafir, outside the fold of Islam. by this denial of his, he can, he leaves the fold of Islam, even by that speech of his and that belief of his. If a person takes the Quran, knowing it to be the Quran, puts it on the floor and kicks it, kafir by that action of his, unbeliever by that action of his, a person who mocks the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and makes mockery of him, belittles the Messenger of Allah, hates the Messenger of Allah, kafir, even if he says la ilaha illallah. So a person can leave the fold of Islam by way of deeds and actions that he does that enter him into major kufr. That we do not deny. But now, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ Whomsoever does not judge. Whomsoever. Whomsoever is not only the rulers. Whomsoever is the rulers and the ruled. Whomsoever. Allah did not specify the rulers. Everyone who does not judge by what Allah has revealed, whether ruled or the rulers. So why is the question coming? You call the rulers today Muslims, even though Allah mentions other than that, that they follow other than the Lord of Allah. What, only the rulers? What, the general, there are no Muslims out there who judge by other than Allah has revealed? When they hear the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they don't want to act upon it? When they hear the commandment of Allah, they don't act upon it? Is that not the judgment of Allah that they are denying and they are not acting upon? Likewise, this applies to them also. And if their opposition reaches the level of major kufr, major shirk, then they leave the fold of Islam. If it is less than kufr, less than major shirk, then they remain in the fold of Islam. No doubt. So now Ibn Kathir likewise mentions the same issue, that this ayah represents kufr that does not exit from the fold of Islam. Why? Because kufr is of two types. Kufr that exits from the fold of Islam and the kufr that is a sin that does not exit from the fold of Islam. So this kufr here is the kufr that does not exit the fold from Islam, though we affirm that there are certain deeds and actions and beliefs that exit the people from the fold of Islam. No doubt, we affirm that. So now, those rulers who, for example, gamble in the casinos, those rulers that allow the Western banks to have interest in their country, interest-based banks in their countries, is the participation in interest a major sin, or is it major kufr that exits from the fold of Islam? Now I'm asking you. Major sin. Is fornication a major sin or major kufr that exits from the fold of Islam? Major sin. Gambling, is it major sin or is it something that exits from the fold of Islam? Major sin. So if a ruler was to now allow this type of behavior to take place in his country, then he's sinful. However, if anyone, whether ruled or not ruled, whether he's a subject or a ruler, commits an act or a belief or a statement of major kufr, after the evidence has been established upon him and the truth being shown to him, and he persists upon that act of major kufr, that there are certain deeds and actions and beliefs that exit the people from the fold of Islam. No doubt, we affirm that. So now, those rulers who, for example, gamble in the casinos, those rulers that allow the Western banks to have interest in their country, interest-based banks in their countries, is the participation in interest a major sin, or is it major kufr that exits from the fold of Islam? Now I'm asking you. Major sin. Is fornication a major sin, or major kufr that exits from the fold of Islam? Major sin. Gambling, is it major sin, or is it something that exits from the fold of Islam? Major sin. So if a ruler was to now allow this type of behavior to take place in his country, then he's sinful. However, if anyone, whether ruled or not ruled, whether he's a subject or a ruler, commits an act or a belief or a statement of major kufr, after the evidence has been established upon him and the truth being shown to him, and he persists upon that act of major kufr or major shirk, then he exits the fold of Islam. We affirm that. This is our aqeedah. I've just given you, 5 or 10 minutes? These are subjects that take hours to study and to learn properly. One ayah you bring, this is that these are people who read an ayah but they don't know what they're reading. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, they will recite the Quran but it will not go beyond their collarbones. Meaning that they will recite it, stop right there at the neck. Doesn't enter the heart, doesn't rise to the intellect. So they don't affirm it, meaning that it doesn't sink into their heart, so they don't know how to act upon it or even understand it. They have no aql. with regard to understanding these ayat because they don't take it back to those ones who understood it best, who were the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So make no mistake, ya ikhwan, with regard to this affair. We have rulers and we have people over us who are sinful, some of them tyrannical, some of them others are just. Some of them are deceived, like Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen mentioned, that a ruler sometimes will commit a crime, even to the point of reaching the level of kufr, but he is excused. Why? Because the advisors around him are the ones who have told him this is from Islam. Have you heard of the Khulafa? Mu'tasib, Al-Wathiq, Al-Mutawakkil. All of these Khulafa, caliphs were in the time of Imam Ahmed. All of them had the belief of kufr that the Quran is created. Imam Ahmed said, likewise Imam al-Bukhari, Imam al-Shafi'i, likewise Ibn Mubarak, and all of the Aimma, Ijma, in fact, that anyone who says that the Quran is created is a kafir outside the fold of Islam. All of these rulers said that the Quran was created. In fact, anyone who did not agree with them, they would execute, or they would imprison, or they would torture. Did Imam Ahmed make takfir upon a single one of them? Not one of them. Why? Because the advisors around these rulers were who? Shayateen. Who? Bishr al-Marisi. Ibn Abi Du'ad. These were the advisors. So Ibn Uthaymeen mentions, rahimahullah, he mentions that sometimes the advisors may be the real culprits, but the ruler is a tool for their corruption. So therefore we withhold from making takfir upon them. Like our brother Abu Iyad mentioned, look how many hundreds and thousands, 2 million did you say? Go to the grave of Al-Badawi. Go to the grave of Ahmed Al-Badawi in Egypt. Before they reach the place which they call the sacred area of the grave of Imam Al-Badawi, what do? They take their shoes off. They say, you can't take your shoes further than a certain point. Then when they get to the grave, they make sajda at the grave. Tawaf of the grave. Shirk or not shirk, ya ikhwan? Shirk. The exits from the fold of Islam. Exits from the fold of Islam. However, the Salafis, they say, listen, we withhold from declaring them to be mushrikeen outside the fold of Islam. Why? Because it is quite possible that many of them are ignorant of the ruling of Islam, that they don't know that making sajda to other than Allah is shirk akbar. They may not know that the ruling of making tawaf around those places is something that may take them outside the fold of Islam. So therefore teach them and explain to them, if they persist after the proof has been established, then they leave the fold of Islam. We are the most fearful of people of making takfir upon others. We don't declare Muslims to be kuffar up until the last resort, up until we've exhausted every avenue of establishing the proof. And look how quickly rulers are kuffar, because I found an ayah in the Pixel translation of the Quran. Ya ikhwan, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Takfir is a big thing. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that whomsoever says to his brother, O kafir, then he returns upon one of them. Meaning the sin of it returns upon one of them. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that if a person says to his brother, O kafir, then it is as if he has killed him. Huge affair, ya ikhwan. But people are falling into shirk, as our brother we had mentioned. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent his humiliation upon those people. Allah sends them upon them hunger. Allah sends upon them tyrannical rulers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes away from them the peace and security that they're in. But they don't want to blame themselves. Because the nature of the human being is what? Is to take everything outside of him and point it towards others. That's what he wants to do. He wants to say, it's not me, it's so and so, it's them, it's the rulers, it's not me. But the way of the Salaf was what? One of the Salaf, he said, when I get onto the back of my riding beast, my horse or my camel, and I find difficulty in my riding beast, and then when I reach my home, and I find that my wife is being difficult and disobedient, he said, wallahi, I know now that I committed a sin. That's how they were. That's how they were, ya ikhwan. How are we? Ruler, it's him, it's Fulan. So now what happens? Every focus is upon the ruler. So next day you meet your brother at university, Akhi, did you hear what Fulan? Yeah, Geneva, you know what he had for breakfast this morning? Obama, or what King Abdullah had for breakfast? You know he's going to Geneva this afternoon? You know he's going to Morocco tomorrow? Akhi, how does this benefit you? Why? Because you are trying now to deflect. Deflect the problem that the Muslims as a whole, that these rulers aren't from Mars. You know, it wasn't, they weren't beamed down from another planet and they've come and aliens have taken over the Muslim lands. They're from us. They are from us, Ya Ikhwan. They are from our generation or the generation that came before. They are from our people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you what you deserve. Al-jaza min jinsil amal. That the recompense is in accordance to the deeds. If the deeds are good, Sahaba radiallahu anhum, who was their leader? Answer. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were the best of the people, they had the best leader. After the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was the ruler? Abu Bakr. Who was he ruling over? Sahaba. They were the best of the people, they had the best leader. In the time of Umar and Uthman, likewise. Then the time of Ali came the bid'ah. The Khawarij and the Qadariya and the Shia. One day after one of the battles, Ali came back. You know what they said to Ali? Radiallahu anhu. The people said, Ali, look at this. In the time of Abu Bakr and Umar, there was no fitna. There was none of this. In your time, look at all the fitna. Why, Ali? Why in your time? Why? Because now they want to deflect off themselves. Maybe there's something wrong with Ali. Radiallahu anhu. Look at the answer of Ali. They said, why in this time fitna with you, Ali? And no fitna in the time of Abu Bakr and Umar. Look at the answer of Ali. Ali said, because in the time of Abu Bakr and Umar, they were ruling over people like me. And in my time, I have to rule over people like you. That's why. Tell them today, Ya Ikhwan. Say, no, you ain't like our brother Wakim. Say, no, you're in the pockets of the governments. You're being paid by the governments. Wallahi, Ya Ikhwan, not a penny have I received from any government. Except maybe some dental care or something in England. Bas, barakallahu feekum, Ya Ikhwan. Jazakumullahu khair.